The origin of life is a tricky thing to piece together. After all, no one was around to see it. But somehow in the primordial soup of the early Earth, simple cell membranes and primitive genetic material arose and coalesced into the first cells. From little more than a hollow shell with little bits of DNA or RNA inside, these so-called protocells evolved into the incredible biological machines of today. Over the past few years, Jack Szostak, a Howard Hughes Medical Institute investigator at Massachusetts General Hospital, has been working to understand how the first cell membranes arose. He's been able to coax simple membranes to form spontaneously from the right molecules. But a question that has stumped him and other researchers is how the building blocks of DNA and RNA, called nucleotides, got inside those membranes and formed genetic polymers in the first place. Modern cells allow access to their interior through complex protein channels, but this couldn't have been the case in early cells because at the origin of life there likely weren't any proteins. By tinkering with their experimental protocell membranes, Szostak and his group may have found the answer to the problem. But Szostak says the work is just one piece in the puzzle of early life.
Well, what we're trying to do is learn something about the origin of life by actually trying to build an early cell or protocell. So there are two main aspects to that. One is the cell membrane, and one is the genetic material.
Now, why is the membrane so important to understanding the early evolution of cells?
The reason is that the cell wants, so to speak, to have control over what gets in and out, right? Which it does by having proteins that control everything that goes across the cell membrane. But if you're thinking about the origin of life, then obviously those complicated protein pumps and channels and pores weren't around. So you need to have a very different kind of membrane. You still want something that's going to enclose the genetic material and keep it from floating away. But you need something that's going to allow the building blocks for the replication of the genetic material to get in without proteins.
So what are modern cell membranes made of, and how does that differ from what you guys created in the lab?
Well, modern cell membranes are made up of phospholipids, cholesterol, and a number of other molecules. The membranes we studied are made up of fatty acids, which are one of the components of phospholipids. So when you make membranes out of fatty acids, they have very different properties. They're much more dynamic. The molecules can flip across the membranes very rapidly. And as it turns out, fatty acid membranes are also a lot more permeable to nucleotides.
Right. So you were able to get nucleotides inside the cells without help. What happened once they got in there?
Right. So one of the most important things that a protocell has to do is replicate its DNA. It's got to take a template strand and make a copy of that template strand. Now, that's something that's in our cells carried out by DNA polymerases. But, you know, the first cells didn't have any of this machinery around. So there had to be a way of getting going without proteins. We were able to do experiments where we add the nucleotides to the outside of the cell, let them diffuse across the membrane to the inside, and then take part in a template copying reaction without proteins.
So I understand that this is just a part of the process. You guys haven't yet figured out how to create that original strand of DNA, and you also don't have a model for the entire replication process. But once you have all that together, what's the next step in your research?
Right. We're trying to start off with a really, really simple system where any sequence could replicate spontaneously. And then, if we could create a large number of those protocells, each bearing different sequences, what we'd like to see is if one of those sequences turns out to do something useful for the cell, whether that useful thing is to catalyze better replication of the genome, or whether it's to do something to help out with the membrane or the cell shape or stability, those sequences will be selected and they'll tend to take over the population.
And that's evolution in action, right? Dr. Szostak, thanks so much for speaking with me.
Thank you.
That was HHMI investigator Jack Szostak. His most recent work on the origins of life appears June 4th in an advanced online publication of the journal Nature. You can also get an interactive look at how life arose and evolved at a website put together by his postdoctoral researcher Janet Isawa. Visit exploringorigins.com. For the Howard Hughes Medical Institute, I'm Benjamin Lester.